I need you back. I never left. Welcome back to Should You Watch This with the Popcorn Priest, a weekly podcast where movie enthusiasts, ex-movie theater projectionists, new and old friends, take the time to talk about a movie that we just watched and answer that very question, should or shouldn't you watch this? I want to extend a shaken but not stirred welcome to our reoccurring guest, JJ, to the show.
Thanks for having me back. Got back from the strawberry fields, ready to go, part two.
Walking in those luscious strawberry fields. Part two. This is our continuing saga of watching the Daniel Craig Bond films with a gentleman, JJ, who has not seen any of them. So that's what we're doing. We're rectifying that.
We got the 2 out of 5.
The solace has been quantumed.
You said you weren't motivated by revenge.
I'm not the ringer with the slick trigger finger for her majesty.
I'm motivated by my duty.
Another one with the golden tongue poison in your fantasy.
You don't have to worry about me.
No, I never told you. A woman walking by. Or someone that you think that you can trust. It's just another thing.
Quantum of Solace. PG-13.
The song in this one is way better, and I still like the Casino Royale Bond song, but this one elevated it to another level. I really enjoyed it, and I enjoyed the intro to
the opening credits are awesome in this movie. Once again, the graphics, the sand, and then yeah, the song by Jack White, We Took Keys.
Yeah,
it's a lot better than the Casino Royale one.
Yeah, what a great, the animation, I mean, that's back in 2008. We don't have AI going on. Someone's happened to do a lot of work there, and it's really great. Good job. Let's jump right into popcorn trivia.
Let me tell you something, Pandeo.
All right, I've got five trivia points that I picked, handpicked for JJ. Daniel Craig wasn't fond of how production went. You think? He was battered and bruised and his fingers were cut off, man. Like, of course he's not happy. Saying that thanks to this, he'd never do another movie without a script nailed down again. Apparently the script wasn't even finished. And they were like writing it as they went. That's not a great thing for a $230 million film. How did that even happen?
Well, this was during the writer's strike.
Oh.
And yeah. They just didn't have that script nailed down. And so I saw things where like Craig and the director were just kind of making stuff up on the fly because they couldn't contact writers at this time.
Oh, that's why. Okay, so that makes sense. And the producers are probably, they wanted to get another Bond movie out after the success of Casino Royale.
Yeah, they probably had some deadlines to hit.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense. Here's another one. Screenwriter Paul Haggis finished his final draft of the script only 2 hours before. Oh, here it is. Before the Writers Guild strike. So 2 hours he finished it. He's probably just like, I gotta finish this and hit a period. Like, he gets as many words out as he can. And then they're going to have to like, they're probably like, Paul, were you high when you wrote this? Like, what is this?
Yeah. Explains like DC's like frustration with it. Daniel Craig.
I agree.
With the whole script.
I agree. This movie is the only Bond movie that has a foot chase, a car chase, a plane chase, and a boat chase.
It's a lot.
A lot of chasing. And I like all of the chases. We talked about the car chase last week, and I kind of feel like they could have done that a little bit better with the editing, but the rest of them were really... The plane chase was really good. Really fun.
So I saw something, their director, Mark Forster, he was going to have 4 big action sequences, and he wanted the 4 action sequences to represent the 4 elements. So earth, water, air, fire. The earth one was the quarry.
Oh.
The water was the boat chase. The air is obviously like the dogfight chase. And then the fire was the hotel on fire.
Dude, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. I think they're like summoning Captain Planet. These action sequences with the elements, but
yeah,
kind of cool.
I like that. That makes it even better. The reason why they had all these chase scenes. Oh, great. Despite ultimately not getting the role of Camille Montes, get this, Gal Gadot When she auditioned, it inspired her to quit law school and pursue acting, debuting in Fast and the Furious in 2009.
Wow.
So her agent said, you should go try out for this movie. And she's like, I'm good modeling. I don't want to act. And then she kind of went and blew it off. And obviously they didn't pick her. But because she went there, she got the acting bug.
We owe Wonder Woman to Quantum of Solace.
I like Wonder Woman. I like Gal. She's a great gal. And
Gal Gadot.
Keep coming into the films. Last one I have is the movie marks the return. Thank you. The return of scantily clad or naked girls dancing in the opening title sequence. That's what we need. It's just part of the formula. You can't mess with the formula. Bring it back. They brought it back. Kick butt song. Naked ladies, scantily clad. They're in sand, so you can't see anything. I love it. It's good. Perfect.
Every Bond movie should have those, I feel like. It should be a checklist.
Yeah, and we're in a more woke era of Bond, and I like that. I like the direction that it's going and has been going. But just give me those little things that we like. Thank you. All right. Did you have any other trivia that you saw or looked at while you're researching?
I got some trivia for you.
Okay.
So the horse race that takes place in Italy.
Yes.
It's an actual horse race.
Okay.
It's called Il Palio.
Il Palio.
And they happen twice a year. And it happens in the city's main medieval square. And it's a competition between the neighborhoods of Siena.
Oh.
So these neighborhoods, they get together. They pick a horse. They pick a jockey. They put some 15th century costume on it.
Oh, yeah. The costumes are crazy.
Because they've been doing it for like 600-700 years. And then the winning neighborhood, the winning horse, they put their banner up for the year.
Oh, dude. It's like Harry Potter.
It's awesome.
You get your banner up.
There's days of festivities, parades leading up to it during the warm-up trials.
There were so many people in those scenes. It was awesome.
Yeah, it was a cool scene. Once again, the quick cuts and the editing is not my favorite during that part, but I was wondering, like, this horse race is crazy. It's in the middle of the city, so it was kind of cool researching some things about it.
I like that they continue to scour the earth for cool, not only just places to shoot, but things like this, events that they can incorporate into the film. And it opens up people to things that I never knew that. I didn't even know that even after I've watched it a couple of times. So that's really cool.
Yeah. And then the other piece of trivia I had was with the whole Bolivia water crisis.
Oh, yeah.
I want to talk about that.
I kind of delved into that a little bit. But yeah, talk about it.
Well, so QoS, you know, the government deprives the citizens of the water supply. It creates a drought. And what happened in real life was even worse. So in Bolivia in 2000, they had a water crisis where they had all these private investors like take control of the water supply.
The water rights were sold to corporations.
Exactly. And then prices surged and people protested. What's really messed up about it is like the evil plot from the movie is less evil than the real life one. Because the intended price hike is less than the one that really happened.
Yes. And I don't want to scare people, but I feel like Bolivia is like the canary in the
mine.
In the mine. Mm-hmm. It's going to happen to us.
Oh, yeah. Water politics right now.
Water's going to be privatized and it's going to get scary. So buy water rights. Buy some water rights. Any more trivia?
I think that's it.
All right, let's get into popcorn puzzles.
A sphincter says what?
What?
A sphincter says what?
What?
Exactly.
All right, I have a few puzzles.
See if we can solve them.
This was just puzzling to me. Pre-production work for QoS began before CR started filming.
Whoa.
How's that even happen? I mean, they didn't film any of it, obviously, but pre-production work started so early, yet they were rushing to get scripts done and they can't edit very well. And they're like, it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, it's crazy. And this is a direct sequel to Casino Royale CR. So how are they planning this before?
I don't know.
It's a puzzle.
It's a puzzle. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. That's why it's in the category. Next one I have is real-life intelligence operatives acted as on-set consultants for the movie, including spies and assassins from MI6 and the Israeli Secret Service. That was surprising to me and puzzling. You have real spies? How do you, like, you put you blur his face for everybody on set? Like, how do you do that?
That's a good question.
Maybe they're ex, like they're retired, but even then, like...
Are spies really retired?
Not Tom Cruise in Mission Impossible. He's not retired.
Never.
Last couple I have are respected Mexican director Guillermo del Toro and Alfonso Cuarón, who directed one of our favorite Harry Potter movies, provided additional voices for the film.
Voices?
Yeah, Guillermo del Toro and Alfonso Cuarón were doing some...
What voices?
Voice acting.
Which ones?
I don't know, maybe like ADR or like, I don't know, Foley work, like... I don't know. It's a puzzle.
That is a puzzle. I want to know where they were at in the movie.
This puzzle creates more puzzles, and I don't think
these puzzles are not answering tonight.
No, that's why I couldn't. They're puzzling.
Yeah.
Okay. Last two. According to Matthew Amalric, Dominic Green, his character does not have any distinguishing features to make him more formidable, and to represent the hidden villains of society. He has no scars, no eye that bleeds, no metal jaw. I tried everything to have something to help me. I said to Mark Forster, no, nothing. Can I have a beard? Can I shave my head? He said, no, I just need your face. That kind of seems like an insult.
It does.
To his face.
Yeah. We don't need any scarring on you. Your face is scary enough.
Your bug-eyed face is just fine, okay?
You're creepy, weird.
Yeah.
Weasley.
Yeah. He does look like a weasel.
Yeah.
Amalric also described Green as not knowing how to fight, so James Bond would be more surprised. Sometimes anger can be much more dangerous, he says. I'm going to fight like I'm in like grade school.
I did notice that, which was surprising. You think villains are going to be all mighty powerful and... He sucks.
He sucks.
Which I like, because a guy that looks like that should suck.
Yeah, it was perfect. Like, I know he was frustrated, but it worked to his advantage.
And what's the puzzle?
The puzzle to me is, I mean, why didn't they give... I mean, I know he kind of describes why they didn't, and we solved our own puzzle here. But at first it was like, why? I mean, you're a Bond villain. You need some kind of weird thing, but...
Is that pretty much the staple of Bond villains? They have something physically different?
I think so. Like a scar or mm-hmm. a deformity or an eye patch or... Yeah, and there's...
Hook?
There's more coming.
All right.
There's more villains that have weird things happening, and it's great. All right, last one I have is, according to Olga Kurylenko...
Andre's sister.
Andre's sister, correct. She was chosen by Mark Forster out of 400 women who were auditioned for the role of Camille because she seemed the least nervous. She spent 3 weeks training with weapons and learned how to fight and body fly, a form of indoor skydiving. Kurylenko dislikes filming stunts, but Daniel Craig's compassion helped her to carry them out. Kurylenko also trained with a dialect coach to perform with a Spanish accent, which was easy since she had a good ear and could imitate people. She was also given a DVD box set of all the 007 movies, since she had not seen any of them, although the James Bond movies are quite well known in her homeland of Ukraine. The later sparked controversy because most of the women they passed over were actually of Latin descent. So she is Ukrainian. I thought it was puzzling that they just didn't hire a Latin. There's a lot of beautiful Latin ladies they could have picked, but...
Is Camilla in future Bonds? Can you spoil it?
This is spoiler zone, so no, she's not.
One and done.
That's fine. I'm fine. I liked her in this. She did a good job, and that's all we need.
Yeah, I agree.
Do you have any puzzles?
Oh, I got some puzzles.
Oh, here we go.
So here's one of my first puzzles. Is an opera the best place for a secret meeting?
It seems like in a lot of spy movies and mafia movies, we got a lot of opera scenes. I don't think so.
I love it, but just thinking from the villain's perspective, you know, over the radio, earbuds, secret meeting at this opera, I just feel like there's probably some other spots I would have gone to.
Yeah, what about like an underground poker, like secret poker area where you can't get in without, or like in a back room?
Yeah.
Or a castle. Like a Scottish castle.
Like a crowded opera. No. And you're just talking in the crowd in your headset.
Yeah.
Making plans.
I like that puzzle.
The other puzzle I had was before Bond's with the redhead, he says to her at his place, I can't find the stationery. And then he immediately sleeps with her. Do you think that line's ever worked in real life?
I mean, I'm writing it down now. Just a second. Let me try. Okay. Let me see if this works on Mrs. Popcorn.
I can't find the stationery.
Do you think that will get me lucky tonight?
It worked for Daniel Craig.
All right.
My third puzzle was the villain, Dominic Green's his assistant, you know, his right-hand man.
Yeah.
That haircut, the bowl cut, puzzling why that was chosen.
I'm so glad you brought it up, because can you not be even more weirder by having a bowl cut?
But I guess like that Weasley, that's probably who he's going to have as his assistant, right? So it works out.
Maybe he, in his attempt to, he was pissed at the director for not giving him some kind of thing. He's like, I'm going to give him myself a bowl cut.
It's puzzling. Yeah. I don't know. The other puzzle was do you know who Rory Kinnear is? Mm-mm. So he's the actor. He plays one of the MI6 chief of staff in this one.
Oh, yeah. I think I remember that.
Anyway, he's also in this episode in Black Mirror where he plays the prime minister in England.
Okay.
And he's, spoiler alert.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. He's the pig.
Yeah. He's forced to have relations with a pig.
Mm.
So my puzzle was, it just every time I saw on my screen, I just kept thinking of the pig and I was puzzling. I just want somebody else in that spot.
Yeah. I would love to be able to go back in time and erase that from my mind. I don't need that in there anymore. And thanks for bringing it up again.
It's a crazy Black Mirror episode.
Yeah, it's good, but also not good.
Yeah, bacon. And then my last puzzle. In the movie, the catchphrase is not said. Bond, James Bond.
I know.
How do you feel about that?
It's a beef.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a good segue.
Yeah. Popcorn. Oh, dude. We went out of order. We usually do beefs. This is... Okay. Usually we do beefs first, but I skipped beefs.
Take you out of your environment and...
Yeah, I'm not in my lair.
You're in the way. Yeah. You're not in your lair.
That's one of my beefs is no Bond, James Bond. And they gave it to us in the end. Which I thought was brilliant at the end. It punctuated that movie. I need that.
So do you need that in every Bond? Because I feel like it was missing.
Yes. These are the... Let me tell you the recipe for a Bond.
Give me your checklist.
You need sexy ladies at the first.
Check.
You need a sick song.
Opening, yeah, agree.
You need... In conjunction with the sick song, you need sick graphics.
100%.
Or animation or something going on at the beginning. You need the barrel shot somewhere, whether it's... You can be creative and put it wherever you want. You can put it at the end, put it in the middle, put it in the... Whatever. I'd rather it in the front of the movie. It kind of sets the stage.
That's one of my beefs, is the gun barrel at the very end. Out of place. Doesn't belong there.
Out of place. You need it at the beginning. You need nice costumes, nice suits, sexy dresses, nice ladies.
Great cars.
Great cars, fast cars, car chases. You need a villain. You need a villain that has some kind of weird deformity. Maybe one of those extra fingers like Strawberry Fields had.
Yep, the nub.
The nubbin. You need, what else do you need? Locations.
Locations, for sure.
You need to go to locations. We need explosions. We need gadgets. But I'm okay not having as many as we had in the Pierce Brosnan era.
I agree.
But we need a little bit.
Yeah. But most of the one-star reviews, they always mention the lack of gadgets, which doesn't really bother me that much.
I just belched. I'm sorry. I'm drinking a soda. It's at the lower list for me.
Yeah.
I don't need that. But all the other stuff, is there any other recipe?
I need Bond to have some relations for a night.
Mm-hmm. He's got so much on his mind.
Yeah.
He needs to relax.
You gotta let it out, bro.
Maybe some hot tubs scenes.
Some ladies covered in oil.
Oil. Yeah. They're some kind of body paint, maybe.
I like a villain with a good lair at the end.
Mm-hmm. I think that's it.
That's a good list.
I like that list. That's all the puzzles I had. We need to go back to beefs.
Okay.
I apologize for going out of order. We're just doing it. We're doing it live.
Popcorn beefs.
Where's the beef? Hey, where's the beef?
All right. In a later interview, Daniel Craig revealed that the script originally wasn't intended to be as much of a sequel to Casino Royale as it ended up being. However, because of the writer's strike, they had only the bare bones of a script, and Craig and director Mark Forster, which you already mentioned, JJ, ended up rewriting a lot of scenes between them, with many decisions being made on the fly and at the last second. Makes sense. Much of the content that made it such a direct sequel to Casino Royale was a last-second addition. Also, the title was chosen more or less at random, which we talked about before. This is a beef. With Craig saying that the most Bond movie titles are meaningless anyway, and they hoped it would sound intriguing. I mean, that's kind of lazy. The title really didn't connect with the script that they had at the time, and the revenge story elements that actually made the title relevant were last-second additions, and I don't agree with any of that. It's a big beef. Title's a beef.
I agree. I talked about it earlier. I don't like this title. Even though, like, you know, he hunts down the person responsible for Vesper, so he does get, you know, his solace, but it's not a lot. Like, I don't care. It's a dumb title. Give me something better.
Yeah, let's say Time to Die. Yeah, I mean,
No Time to Die?
Well, yeah, that's the next one, but the last one, but yeah, so that's a B for me. Next one, the movie marks the first time since Only Live Twice in 67 that Bond does not introduce himself with Bond, James Bond. We already talked about this. It is a beef. The line was shot. Listen to this. The line was shot for several different scenes. So there is there's film out there.
They made the decision not to like put it in. The hour 45 minutes, they couldn't stick it in.
Completely cut out as director Mark Forster, and the producers found it unnecessary. The other staple Bond line stating the vodka martini shaken not stirred also doesn't appear in the movie. Not as bad, but having both of those not in the film, egregious beef.
And that should be on the checklist too. I need my Bond drinking his vodka martini.
Yes. He needs some downtime with the ladies and he needs some alcohol.
Yes.
All right. My next beef. As with Casino Royale, the fully orchestrated James Bond theme isn't heard until the end of the movie. This time during Daniel Craig's new official gun barrel sequence, which we already beefed about, as well as the start of the ending credits, making the first time that a gun barrel sequence with Daniel Craig is accompanied by the James Bond theme. Since the version of the sequence used in Casino Royale dropped it completely, being accompanied instead by an opening bars of the theme song of that movie, You Know My Name. It is also the second consecutive Bond movie that ends with the James Bond theme during the credits, followed by a vocal or instrumental track. Beef.
Beef. Give me that song.
Give me the song. Last two I have, James Bond and leading Bond girl Olga Kurylenko shared a kiss in the movie, but they do not make love, making it the first for a James Bond film. Cars, gadgets, Q, girls, Money Penny, Spy. You can still have a darker, gritty movie, but I think this lacks what Casino Royale delivered. I'm not saying this is a bad film, but there are elements that you need. Are you putting cantaloupe slices in your chocolate cake? No, you're not. You're putting chocolate in your chocolate cake. That's what makes it a chocolate cake. We talked about the recipe. You can't put weird. It's like when you go to Thanksgiving dinner and someone's messing around with the stuffing. Don't put cranberries. Don't put weird crap in there. Just make normal stuffing. Make normal gravy. We don't need weird crap into gravy.
Mm-hmm.
Just make a Bond film. I'm fine as if you're making it more woke, more pushing it to more gritty and more dark, more realistic. But give me those pieces in there. That's all I'm saying.
So this is the first time that Bond's kissed somebody and then didn't sleep with them later.
I know we can't be chauvinistic. Two consenting adults can have a nice time.
He sealed the deal.
Correct. My last beef, this isn't as big as all the other ones. Those are pretty big beefs. This last one, Sir Paul McCartney turned down the offer to write the new James Bond song for this movie and recommended Amy Winehouse for the job. Winehouse recorded a demo with music producer Mark Ronson. The demo was not used for reasons linked to Winehouse's inability to record music at a time due to her well-publicized personal situation. So it's a small beef, but I think it would have been dope to have a Paul McCartney song, and I also think it would have been dope to hear Amy Winehouse do a song.
Agreed. The Paul McCartney song would have been super interesting.
He's done one before, so it'd be cool to have him do another one. And he's British.
Checking all the boxes.
Like, that's a beef. That's all the beefs I have.
Some good beefs. I got some beefs.
All right.
First beef is with Mathis. He's just done dirty, bro.
I'm glad you brought that beef up.
He's shot by dirty police. He's dumped in the garbage. And then Bond takes his money.
He freaking rips him off.
Just, I know there is some, is he a good guy, bad guy? But I think he redeems himself. And I just think he's done dirty.
Yeah, I do like that there is a tender moment between Bond and him where he's like, just stay here with me while I die.
Yeah, he's holding him, but then the next scene is him throwing him in the garbage.
I mean, it's just a shell now, I guess, it's Bond.
Yeah.
Give me your money.
It's my beef. Mathis deserves better. My second beef is some bad CGI.
There's a couple bad special effects.
The plane scene when they're falling in the air and they pull the parachute last second, I think there's some bad CGI.
Yeah, that could, again, back to the editing we said was a little bad. I think there could have been some, I mean, they spent so much money on this. How did we not get a better falling
scene? Yeah, but you mentioned, too, the 900 visual effects. Like, we talked about Casino Royale. When those stunts are done real, like, they look so much better.
Yeah. Maybe, here's a pro tip, Bond producers. Go call up Tom, be like, hey, can we sit at your mansion for a couple hours and talk about how to do real stunts?
Do you think TC is going to allow that? Like, you think he is going to help the Bond franchise? He's Ethan Hunt.
Tom Cruise loves film.
That's true.
And he wants it to be good.
Yeah, you're 100%.
So I think he will. I don't think he's going to give all of his secrets.
Okay.
But he's going to be like, listen, do these five things. Yeah. And it'll be
He's going to give him some nuggets.
All right.
Not the whole piece.
I agree. That's what I'm saying.
All right, and then my last beef was, I just thought this ending was weak. M tells Bond that Green dies, which I'm sus on. We don't show he's dead, so if he doesn't come back in future movies, I think I don't like this ending even more. And then Bond throws Vesper's necklace in the snow, which I really hope that's the last mention of her. I'm over her. I'm hoping James is over her.
I can neither confirm nor deny any more mention of Vesper.
That's fine. And I just thought the ending was weak. And maybe it's a build up to something bigger, because I know we have Skyfall next and I'm super excited about it. Weak ending, I thought.
I agree. I support that beef. Although I like the movie. Yeah.
And then the gun barrel scene, which we touched on, so out of place.
It's weird. That sets the tone. It's like turning on the lights. It's like, let's start. We're starting. Turning off the lights when you go to a movie. It's like, we're starting a Bond movie. We need that to kick us off.
Yeah.
You ready for redemption since we're doing everything out of order?
Excuse me.
Popcorn redemption.
I have exorcised the demon.
All right. Popcorn redemption is where we talk about things that we liked. We just went over beef, so it's apropos that we went out of order. I liked this. I thought this was kind of cool. Director Mark Forster thought Dame Judi Dench was underused in the previous movies, which is why she has such a bigger part to play in this. He had her interact with James Bond more because she's the only woman Bond doesn't view in a sexual context. And that's not true, Mark, because we already established that Olga just gives him a peck on the... You know, that's nothing. But what I love about it is I just like Judi Dench. I like that she's in it more. And to be honest, it sets up a great Judi Dench storyline for Skyfall, which get ready to live.
Yes, sir. I'm on board with that. I liked M was in it more this one.
Mm-hmm.
That is a good redemption for sure. Because she is the one that can check Bond. She has some good one-liners.
Yeah.
And she just kind of puts him in his place because he's a little cocky sometimes.
Yeah, I love their interactions. It's almost as if, I mean, he talks about her as mom, you know, and it's great.
Is that what the M stands for?
It's actually the initials of her first name.
Oh.
We find that out in Casino Royale.
I remember now.
Okay, thank you. I don't really have any specific redemption other than the fact, well, I might get into this in my rating, so I might save that, but... We kind of talked about the things that I liked over the last two pods, so I don't have any more redemption, realistically.
Mm-hmm. I got one.
Okay.
I really like the sound design of this movie. There's some really good scenes, like the opening car scene with Aston Martin, the gears changing, the engines revving. I think the sound's really good in that one. The opera scene is going back to the music and the chasing, the fighting, and then even like when they don't use music, there's the hotel fight scene when Bond's fighting one-on-one with that guy. There's no soundtrack, so you're just hearing the knives, the glass breaking, the scuffle. I like the sound design in this one.
Yeah, were you able to turn off the panting of the subtitles?
I did figure that out, I just got pure dialogue.
Dialogue only.
No, no grunting on this one.
Dude, I just remembered something from last episode that I forgot to mention.
Ooh.
That is kind of a beef / puzzle / redemption.
So it's all of them. Let's hear it.
So there's a rumor of an actor who is supposed to play General Medrano in this movie. Guess who they wanted to play General Medrano?
I think it's going to be good. Give it to me.
Al Pacino. Can you imagine Al Pacino in a Bond movie?
Oh my gosh. What a waste. That's a beef.
That's a beef.
Give me Pacino in that role.
Wow.
Yeah, he'd be out of his mind.
That would have been amazing. Because he's, you know, old and craggly and grumpy. And that would have been really cool.
Yeah.
As a kind of older dictator, you know.
Yeah, I want to see Pacino as bad guys more, for sure.
Anyway, sorry for the retroactive beef, but...
Glad you brought it up.
But yeah. Any other redemption? I like that talk about the sound design. And I think the cinematography really is really great in this.
Yeah, there's some great shots for sure.
Yeah, especially in the when he's driving out to drop the villain off and give him his little water bottle of crude oil, which I love that he's like, you're going to drink this. And he actually does. I love that.
I mean, but, we are told he does. We're not shown once again.
Well, if whatever they tell me, that's all I'm going to take is gone. Honest gold. But when he's driving in the whatever car he's in, that wide shot with the dust. Oh, man, there's some really cool shots.
The shot, too, when he's hanging from the rope and he does the one gun shot.
Oh. Because
he's killed the bad guy chasing him from the rooftop. That's a really cool shot.
The wide shot of the even though it's arguably crappy CGI, but the hotel kind of blowing up in succession.
Oh, yeah.
Is really nice against the backdrop of the, you know, desolate desert. It's really good. All right, no more redemption. You want to get into the rating?
Let's get it.
All right, I don't have a soundbite for the rating. So I wanted to read this before I say my rating. As the first direct sequel, Daniel Craig commented, "We feel we needed to tie up the loose ends from Casino Royale and make sure people realize we're back making Bond movies. For me, it's about creating something that is going to stand alone. But if you put the two films together, you're going to have an incredible experience because you'll see one continuous story." The reason why I bring that up is my rating, and I know I'm going to get lambasted for this, maybe from you and everyone else, but this is where I'm at. I think this is a strong medium bucket when you look at QOS by itself. But when you watch these back to back, I think this elevates to a large bucket, in my opinion. There, I said it.
No, I think that's a fair and accurate statement.
Okay. What do you rate it?
I completely agree.
You the same?
I was going to give this a medium, but if you do watch this back to back and listening to the pod with all the fun trivia and you kind of know there's some stuff.
Shameless plug.
Like and subscribe. It bumps that up for sure. So it's strong medium, but it has potential for more.
Yeah, I think it's a weaker Bond film. Not horrible. That's why it's a medium bucket. It's in the middle. But if you watch it back to back, I think it elevates it to a large bucket. So there you go.
Yeah, I think that's spot on. I liked it more than I thought I was going to because I knew like this one kind of gets, you know, shitted on.
Correct.
And given the bad title, I didn't have high expectations for it.
I also thought you said something interesting today when we were driving in the car. You said that I think I'm going to like this better when I watch it again. And this was the second time I've seen it. And I enjoyed it way better the second time for sure. Especially with the other.
The plot's super confusing with the CIA and then the Bolivia water crisis. And, is it oil? Is it water? What's going on here? And I think the more you watch it, the kind of more you pick up on stuff and understand it and appreciate it more.
Correct. Do you have any parting thoughts?
No. So excited for Skyfall. We've made it to Skyfall. This is the reason why we're doing the pod.
I know. Yeah. You're like, I want to watch Skyfall. And I'm like, you can't. You got to watch all of them. So we're ready for Skyfall. And you are also ready for Skyfall. So let's go.
Let's go.
That's it for this week. But I'm with you always. I love movies, and I would love it if you share the love. Share this with the movie lover in your life. If you made it this far, go give us a 5-star review on Spotify or Apple Podcast. I commend thee. As always, thanks for listening, and thanks to my special guest, Quantum of JJ. Thanks for coming, man.
Thanks, Popcorn.
And I'm really excited, and I appreciate having people like you, guests that come on the show that give me an opportunity to watch movies like series. It's really fun for me, and the deep dive always makes for a great time. So thanks. Remember, when you watch movies, you can pop off, pop in, or pop out, but always bring the popcorn. We'll see you next week.